It's already 2 years ago that you've been seeing Windows emulation on Unix when I was showcasing Soft Windows 95 on SGI Irix. Although Soft Windows was also available for Sun's Solaris operating system, I want to delve into something different today. The SunPCi coprocessor board that adds a fully functional x86 PC right into your Sun workstation. And while I'm on it, let's go figure if this missing IDE header can be populated to connect the real hard drive. Retrocomputing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories. On our present day, running a virtualized guest operating system is no big deal. Even very basic machines have enough power to do this, thanks to CPU-assisted virtualization technology that was introduced in the mid-2000s. Before that, running a non-native guest operating system required an emulation software like Insignia's Soft Windows 95, which did implement a CPU-accurate emulation in software. Naturally, that was quite slow, and the only alternative that had been in use since the early 80s was to equip the machines with a coprocessor board. The SunPCi was already quite advanced, bringing not only its own dedicated RAM and peripheral connection capabilities, but also quite powerful AMD K6-2 at 400 MHz. And while I didn't have this one in my Sunblade workstation in the early 2000s, but the later generation SunPCi 3, which came with a 1.4 GHz CPU, this wasn't actually the first single board add-in PC by Sun. In the years prior, Sun offered SunPCi with add-in boards that sported a 133 MHz AMD 5x86 by 1997 and 486 SX and DX class CPUs before that. SunPCi was intended to provide better compatibility and performance to run Windows software on Sun OS as opposed to Sun's 1992 Wabi product, which provided an application binary interface only.
That sounds a lot like wine.
Maybe to some extent, yes, in the sense to make Windows applications run on Unix. But reading briefly into the Wabi documentation seems to indicate that you were still required to also install a copy of Windows 3.1 alongside with it as a runtime. That's completely different from Wine, which doesn't require Windows runtime at all, but brings its own implementation. Anyway, it was runtime translated, which didn't offer the best performance back then, while Sun ultimately went the hardware acceleration route. Of course, the SunPCi is primarily meant to be equipped to Sun workstations. I sold off all my Sun machines over 15 years ago, so the only machine I have is this Sunfire V120 Pizzabox server. I won't be able to permanently keep the SunPCi in that machine, as otherwise I can't close it. But for the sake of demoing it, this machine is perfectly capable of temporarily hosting the SunPCi board. During startup, there's no indication yet that you now have a PC inside your Sun machine, except that yet another fan is spinning. There have been three releases for SunPCi, ranging from version 1 through version 3. As this is the first revision mainboard, I'll be installing the SunPCi 1.3 package. Keep in mind that I'm doing so on Solaris 9, so it will report an error at the end of the installation process, as it's not officially compatible. This can be fixed though by creating some symlinks and then rebooting the machine. Of course, the Sunfire V120 doesn't have graphics output, and so no local desktop. But, as I was using this machine before to showcase the Sunray terminal product, I'll be just using the same for the demo. And meanwhile, I have found a keyboard and mouse to go along with the Sunray 1G client, so it really builds up that Sun look and feel. And, as a further callback to my previous episode, here's that ominous props key I was missing on the PC keyboard and thus had to find a workaround for. The SunPCi software was installed to /opt/sunwspci, and running the SunPCi command from the bin directory will get us going. It will complain first that the drivers must still be enabled, though once that hurdle is taken, I'm asked to create the virtual hard disk image. This will reside in my home directory and can be any size between 1 to 8000 megabytes. On startup, you wouldn't be able to tell directly that this isn't a full-blown emulation but runs off the acceleration board. It looks very much like modern day's VirtualBox or VMware. And even so it runs in a window, the SunPCI card does have physical connectors, so you can also wire up dedicated input peripherals and a separate monitor. I'll be showing that in a moment. At first, it boots into Caldera OpenOS 7, the only operating system that comes bundled. Not much to see here, and I want to proceed with the Windows installation. Now, even so it has an option to mount the physical CD-ROM drive, that won't be bootable. One has to go a different route. Luckily, the default OpenOS comes with a redirector service already installed, which makes your home directory available as drive H. So I copied the Windows 98 setup files to my home directory to launch the Windows setup from there. There's not much fuss around installing Windows 98, it feels exactly as you'd be doing on a real PC. The only thing notable at this point is that it feels a bit choppy and the mouse pointers are not in sync, making it hard to control. Installing the drivers, which are found on drive F, again provided by said redirector service, solves that issue and also provides for VGA color support and higher resolutions. When looking into Device Manager, keep in mind that some of the components seen here are in fact physical hardware, with only a few exceptions like the hard drive or the network card being emulated. Now, I had observed that the SunPCI complains about the BIOS version mismatch on startup. I had ignored it, but actually, following the procedure outlined in the install guide, it's as easy as running the SunPCI flash command. I'll have it save the previous BIOS version nevertheless, just in case. And if you're into tinkering, then why not join today's episode sponsor PCBWay for your electronic design and 3D printing projects. We partnered for the latter many times, like here for the stand for the Sunray 1G terminal and these beautiful trim reproductions for the Silicon Graphics 02.
So if you need services, maybe PCBWay can help you. And now, up to the soldering part.
Furthermore, I want to track down that unpopulated IDE header. Even so, those virtual hard drive images are stored on the Solaris file system and exposed as hard drives in SunPCI's BIOS, I wonder if it could work to wire up a real hard drive. Normally, I step away from doing mods, but I think I can perform the soldering well enough to not screw up the board. But first I need to remove the solder from the through holes in order to fit the socket. So it's all by flying cabling, but good enough to attach this IBM hard drive as a primary master. Though even so, disabling the C drive pointing to the image file in the sunpci.ini file only yields me to create a new disk image. So that seems to not work. But maybe if I reconnect the drive as a primary slave. Oh wow, it really gets detected. Awesome! But my happiness isn't a long-lasting one, as FDisk still reports only the virtual drive C. And even so, I tried with different settings in sunpci.ini, even inspecting the SunPCi startup script, I couldn't get it to run. I found a possible hint in the BIOS README, noting about the maximum disk size supported being 8 GB. And as the IBM drive was 30 GB in size, I swapped it for a Western Digital 3.5 GB drive, but to no avail. Eventually, I was doing string dumps on the binaries and lib files, hoping to find something useful. This revealed those two keywords for ignoring the emulated C and D drives. But as obvious as it is, potentially being INI file keywords, going to sunpci.ini, it wouldn't work, probably because it doesn't go to the drive section, but needs another magic section name I didn't figure out yet. Even that statement here about disk 32 being enabled, whatever that means, didn't make any difference. The physical drive remains detected in the BIOS, but it's not passed over, probably as this wasn't meant to be a real use case. I guess I need to further drill down using a debugger to make it work. With interrupt 13 verbose logging enabled, at least I see the BIOS accessing drives 2 and 3, which correspond to drives C and D respectively. But still, booting into DOS only yields requests to drive C, aka the C drive. And when furtherly looking again at FDisk, no request goes to drive 3, indicating the physical drive was not registered via interrupt 13 hex after the BIOS performed the disk detection. Oh my. Meanwhile, wiring up the SunPCi board to dedicated peripherals brings back memories of 23 years ago when I had the SunBlade 150 with the SunPCi 3 card, giving me best of both worlds on my desktop. While officially only DOS and Windows were supported, some people have managed to also run Linux and BSD as a guest OS on the SunPCi. And using command line arguments, it was as easy as directing SunPCi at different config files, so you could switch between different operating systems. So tell me, did you come across SunPCi, or even the earlier SunPC, or even the Wabi product, which apparently also ran on HP Unix, AIX and SCO Open Server? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again next Sunday.